When it comes to ear training, the first question a lot of students ask me is, should I learn my intervals? An interval is the distance between two notes. So for example, from C to F is a perfect fourth. From C to A flat is a minor sixth. And you can learn to recognize the sounds of these distances. So the idea with interval training is you get really good at hearing all those distances, and eventually that adds up to being able to recognize all the notes in a melody, or even recognize a chord progression. Now, I don't know about you, but that has always seemed to me like a huge leap to go from recognizing two isolated notes to being able to hear an entire melody in real time and then play it back on your instrument. Like just in that little melody fragment I just played you, there are so many different intervals and they're happening so quickly. There's a minor second and then a major third, a minor third, a major third. And if you were to get any of those wrong, like let's say I went minor second and then I thought this was a minor third, it would mean that I'd be off for a half step by the rest of the notes in the melody. So trying to use interval training as a way to hear entire pieces of music is a little bit like learning your way around a new neighborhood by measuring very precisely the distances between different locations in the neighborhood. So there's another way to train your ear that's a little bit more like looking at a map and getting a sense for where everything is in relation to everything else. This other form of ear training is called functional ear training, or solfege. And it's typically presented as a further step after you've mastered your intervals. But in this video, I want to compare these two approaches, and I'd like to make the case that you should actually just start with functional ear training and don't worry about intervals when you're a beginner to ear training. Before we get started, I do suggest that you learn the names of your intervals because they're a very helpful piece of musical terminology, and I can teach them to you really quick here. So we name the intervals based on the major scale of the bottom note. So if our bottom note is C, then we'll use a C major scale, and we have four major intervals for the second note of the major scale. This is a major second. The third note of the major scale, major third. This is a major sixth and a major seventh. Now, all of those major intervals can become minor intervals if you lower them by a half step. So this is a minor second, minor third, minor sixth, and minor seventh. Then we have two perfect intervals. That's a perfect fourth on the fourth note of the scale and a perfect fifth. In between them is the tritone, which can also be called an augmented fourth or a diminished fifth. And that's it for your intervals. So this is yet another reason to learn your major scales, because you need to know the major scale for the bottom note in order to name an interval. If you don't know an A flat major scale, you're gonna have trouble naming this as a major sixth. But if you do know your A flat major scale, it's easy to see that that's the sixth note of the scale. So if you don't know your major scales, I have some videos on the topic and you can always grab my free PDF guide to the shapes of all 12 major scales. So that's it for the names of intervals. And in a lot of approaches to ear training, the next thing you do after learning those names is you start practicing with intervals and you want to recognize the sound of a minor sixth or the sound of a major sixth. The alternative to that is to use solfege or functional ear training. And this is where you're learning to recognize the notes of a scale within the context of a piece of music. So for example, using this little melody from the Suzuki method. Rather than hearing all of the distances between those individual notes, we hear the key of the piece. It's pretty obviously in F. That's our home, and that's where we want to end the melody. And then we can identify these as 1, 1, 2, 3, 3, 4, 5, 6, 5, 3, 5, 4, 3, 2, 4, 3, 2, 1. And so using numbers like that as the functional ear training approach, and solfege just gives different syllables to all those numbers. Do, do, re, mi, mi, fa, so, la, so, mi. So it might seem on the face of it like these two approaches, interval training versus solfege, are about equally difficult, or maybe it's even harder to do the solfege because you're trying to hear a whole melody why not make it easier and just do two notes at a time? And I think that's the mentality behind giving interval training to students first. It seems that we're making things simpler by just isolating it down to two notes. But that's not really how our ear works, right? We're used to hearing much more context in a piece of music. The only time we hear just two pitches next to each other might be like a phone ringing or some sort of microwave beeping. And when those things happen, it's nice knowing your intervals because it's kind of a fun party trick to say, hey, the microwave sounds like it's a tritone, right? But other than that, it just doesn't come up that often that you're hearing two notes in isolation like this. And we do better with more context. It's like how when you zoom way in on an image, you have so little context that you can't even tell what you're looking at. And then you might zoom out again, and even though you're looking at more, you have a better understanding of that little zoomed in part of the picture. The same thing is true in music. And the evidence for it is right there in the way that we teach interval training. If a student is having trouble recognizing the sounds of intervals, teachers often give example songs to make it easier. So a perfect fourth is "Here Comes the Bride." Perfect fifth is Star Wars. Major sixth is "My Bonnie Lies Over the Ocean." And so on. When we're using an example song, we're letting the student rely on their memory of the context of the piece, the key of the piece, and all that extra musical information that you don't get when you're just hearing two notes, right? If we instead think of "Here Comes the Bride," we imagine in our heads those other chords and the context of the piece of music. So even teachers who think they're starting students on interval training are actually bankshot using functional ear training or solfege as a way to make the intervals easier. I only ever got really good at intervals by imagining I was in some sort of key center, starting with the first note that I heard. And then if it got too weird in that key, let's say it started in C and it was a lot of white notes that all made sense, hearing this as one, and then suddenly it switched to lots of black keys, I might change in my head where I was hearing one, ba. And maybe this is one now, so this is two, five, and four. And that's how I got good at interval training. It was really just through using my ability to hear scale degrees, my ability to use solfege or functional ear training. That's what made me good at intervals. Okay, so let's say you're totally sold. You're like, I don't need intervals. I'm gonna do this solfege thing. I wanna learn functional ear training. How do I get started? Well, I have three pieces of advice. One is you can use an ear training app. That kind of turns it into a game. There are a lot of great ear training apps out there, but they typically will suggest interval training as one of the first steps. And you might have to kind of dig through some menus or settings to practice functional ear training and recognize the numbers of the scale. So I recommend Functional Ear Trainer. It is an app that is all built around this approach. It gives you a cadence, a quick chord progression, to set you up in the sound of a key or a song, and then it will quiz you on notes within the scale. And it gets harder from there and working up to where it gives you the cadence in a random key, and then you are hearing notes even from the chromatic scale, but still relating them back to that home key. So I highly recommend that app. Other more open-ended things you can do to practice, you can practice sight singing, and I would recommend a book like, where did I put it? Sing at First Sight is one I've used with my students. They have a few different levels. And a sight singing book like that is likely to use this solfege approach. You're gonna be singing through pieces of music. So you'll be set up in a key, you'll have more context, and you'll be learning to recognize the degrees of a scale, with or without solfege syllables, do, re, mi, and so on. And my third suggestion is one of my favorite exercises to suggest to students. If you're a fan of the channel, you've heard me talk about this before. Take simple melodies and put them in different keys. And this doesn't seem like an ear training exercise, but it can be really good for your ear. Because in order to put a melody into a new key, first you have to figure out what key you're in, and then you have to assign numbers to all the notes. So the act of doing that starts to associate a sound with a number. And you're already familiar with the sounds, you just haven't attached numbers to them yet. So that's my third recommendation. Practice with an app, practice sight singing, and practice transposing melodies. And between those things, you'll start to get to where you can just do this with real music. You know, take a piece of music you like and try to imagine it being played on a piano keyboard away from the instrument, and then test your guess and see how close you were. Now, there's one important caveat with all of this. I don't have perfect pitch. Now, if you're watching an ear training video, I'm assuming that you probably also don't have perfect pitch, but it's worth testing if you never have. See if you can hold on to the sound of, say, middle C and still remember it a day later. And if you're able to do that, you might have some form of absolute pitch or perfect pitch, which is basically long-term pitch memory. You can remember the sound of a note. I do not have this. The majority of people don't have this. Even the majority of professional musicians do not have perfect pitch. But that doesn't have to stop you from training your ear to a point where it's just about as useful as the ear of someone with perfect pitch. In fact, there are some advantages and disadvantages to both kinds of ear development. Anyway, take that with a grain of salt. You know, I can only teach people how to train their ears in the way that I trained my ears. Relative pitch, and it applies to most people. But if you do happen to be one of the lucky few who has absolute or perfect pitch, you're kind of like a 7-footer learning to play basketball. There are things you can do that don't really apply to the basketball game of a normal-sized person. And so I don't know if you should worry that much about the things us regular-sized people are trying to learn how to do, you know, shoot a good jump shot. Maybe that does help with the 7-foot people too. So I don't know if it's a great metaphor, but it's a little like rock climbing too. If you're really tall, you just use different sets of holds on the same route compared to someone who's short and has to find their own beta. If you have any lingering questions about this idea of assigning numbers to things based on where they are in a scale, I do have another video that's just about that. You can also leave me any questions in the comments. Always happy to hear from you. My name is Ted. Happy practicing.